Mark, look at my new sweatshirt. I bought it from our shop. Look, it's our logo, see? And that's you, and that's me. So what do you think?
Shouldn't you be wearing pants?
My eyes!
Oh, no.
The following podcast contains graphic descriptions of international celebrating and global merrymaking. It may not be suitable for angry or unhappy audience members. Listener discretion is advised. You've been warned.
Have you ever seen any of those foreign films? I don't like them.
Lord, you! Make Christmas last forever.
Some are born great, others achieve greatness, and some watch Christmas movies.
Both festive, aren't they?
And we are the festive foreign film fans. Well, hey there, Mark.
Bob, I am in the bestest of moods today.
I love that.
It's going to be a great show. We're going to have some fun tonight, but I couldn't be any happier.
You're kind of are sparkly. What's going on?
I'd like you to say I'm glowing.
Mark, you are glowing.
Thank you. Because being in this reviewing this movie today, like I felt like I was in a nice warm climate, right? Not in this bitter cold of February. So like I turned all the lamps on in my house and I put my face up next to them. So I'm ready
that
to go.
That is why I can see the little bronze, effort happening there because you are absolutely right. Here we are in the midst of our winter, dark, cold, and guess where we're going today?
I know I'm taking the fans to Nigeria.
We are going to Africa. Can you sing a little of that? The Toto song? Wow, and you're dancing too. That's perfect. And you know, I love this because we do try to balance. I mean, you know, it's easy to find Christmas movies in those cold environments, but I mean, we've done Mexico, we've done India, we've done Turkey. And tonight, like you said, it is Nigeria, and it's warm there.
It is.
So, you know, what is funny is now, so that's what's four films, four, and we've seen some warm weather Christmases. And what I'm wondering is, are they similar to what we do? Are they different? Mm-hmm. Do you notice any different customs or traditions? Is there anything that we go, hey, we should do that. We should bring that up north.
Yeah. You know, I think there's more similarities than differences for sure. Right. The holiday and whether it's, you know, you're celebrating the Christian birth of Jesus or you're even like in some of the places we went to visited around the world had Christmas more of as a romantic holiday. But I'd say again, the more similarities, but I think what I am a little envious of some of the countries you mentioned is the time of year they're having it. It's a warmer climate. And so the ability to go out and celebrate outside, and I think would maybe there'd be more opportunities, more community-based celebrating than right our individual houses and with the doors closed and the, you know, the warm heat on. And so like in tonight's movie, part of the build-up to Christmas is planning this village-wide festival that people are going to go and celebrate. And it just seems like that is something that would be interesting and maybe a little bit of fun to experience someday.
You know, Mark, I didn't think about that, but you are absolutely correct in terms of, you know, there are friends that you say, okay, we hibernate for months and you don't see them for the whole of Christmas or not the whole of winter because you're not going out as much. You're not doing as much. So that's absolutely true. What I was thinking about is one is It's a great question, but I think you find way more similarities than differences. Now, I know we haven't seen, and we will see some in the future, probably some that are on the beach or an oceanfront and a yeah. lot more going to the beach and being out in the sun. The ones that we've looked at are kind of more still metropolitan, you know, right. in cities, so urban. So you don't get as much of that kind of stuff, but you are envious because when they do want to go outside to see fireworks or go
right.
to do things, it isn't. I recall I was listening to someone talk about that they went to the zoo lights, you know, for Christmas, and they said it was like 5 degrees in the windshield below zero. And they started and they had their kids and all that, and they were probably there 5 minutes and looked yeah. at each other and said, what are we doing here?
Yeah.
This isn't fun. And so you do run into some of that. But the flip side of that would be, you know how it is around 4th of July. People are, oh, it's so hot. I don't want to do anything. You know what I mean? So there's always going to be some grumbling.
Right? Yeah, and I guess it's probably just common, right, that what somebody else is doing is somehow different and you maybe think it's better. I mean, I'm sure I've had people who have grown up in the South experience their first snowfall.
Yeah.
Right? And the magic part of that. And so there's people who want to have a white Christmas and have that little bundling up and stuff. So I guess it's what you know and what you grow up with. But yeah, I just think it'd be fun to be able to have a big outdoor festival and not worry about getting frostbitten.
And see a lot of your friends that you don't yeah. get to see. And the one thing, you're right, we have romanticized snow that the people in the southern climes, they want a white Christmas. Us up north, we still want a white Christmas. Now, right. I always am upset when we don't have a white Christmas, but, you know, 2 weeks after, I'm, you know, it could go away because then it becomes yeah. just, you know, a slushy mess and shoveling and, you know, trying to drive in it and all that. But for Christmas, I want it white.
You know, it's funny. We've asked our boys, and I mean, they're grown men now with their own families, but like, what's been favorite shows you've gone to? But like, what's your favorite Christmas? Like, and it's funny, independently, they both said one Christmas when we went to Midnight Mass, and it was sort of just flaking when we went in. By the time we got out, though, there's probably 3 or 4 inches of snow. And we went home, and at like 2 o'clock in the morning, we were out front building a snowman.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and it was just like, sort of magical. It was a magic Christmas Eve snow that came. And so it's
well, plus that you all went out and built that's great. I love that story.
Yep. But you ready to talk about this Christmas?
I'd love to.
This movie, yes. Yeah. Christmas movie. Let's talk about it.
Want to watch a Christmas movie?
Christmas movies are our bread and butter.
We eat Chinese food and watch Christmas movies.
I heard it's the best Christmas movie since Home Alone.
Okay, so tonight's movie was released in 2021, and it's called A Naija Christmas. It is based in Nigeria, but let's talk about the actors, because there's some really phenomenal actors and actresses in this movie. First one I would call out plays Mama, or Agatha Agu. Her name is Rachel Onogo. She's from Aku, the Delta State in southern Nigeria. Her acting career was actually born out of a divorce in 1993.
Oh, wow.
She was working for a consulting company, a Dutch consulting company, when she decided to act and has appeared in several notable Nigerian films and television series, but no U.S. film. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, she died suddenly at the age of 64 in 2021.
Yeah, there's a memorial to her at the front, and yeah. it's too bad because she has a really big personality.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, I loved her.
She's the best.
Yeah.
So that, and you'll hear me probably refer her to her as Mama
yes.
during the movie. Because
how could you not?
Exactly. And then the next actor who plays Chike is Tawasi Abinomi Alvin. He's a Nigerian actor and model. He started acting in 2013 and appeared in some notable Nollywood productions. He also appeared in some famous Nigerian television series. And in 2022, he was cast in Nigerian's first dance drama TV series. So I guess that's like Dancing with the Stars, I'm assuming.
Now, Mark, there's the three brothers, and I apologize, even though I've seen it twice, I can't So Chike, is he the one who gets engaged?
So we'll talk about that in a minute. In fact, but Chike is actually the youngest of the three.
Oh, he is the youngest one. Yep. Okay. Okay.
Yep. In fact, for this movie, I'm going to review it in a little bit different way than I've done other movies.
Oh, okay.
I'm going to do it in French.
impressive.
The next actor who plays Obi, is his acting name is Efe Aware, and he's from the Ugepe in Cross River State. He graduated from the University of Abadan with a bachelor's degree in geography. He started his career as a musician in a group called X Factor, which when I read that, I'm like, that sounds familiar. But following the breakup of the group, he released a 5-track album himself, and he's appeared on MTV. At the time, it was for Ebony Life TV and then a TV series and films, but no U.S. Performances.
Now, you might have been the X Factor was a show, too. Maybe you're thinking of the show.
Yes, that's what I'm thinking of. I'm like, why does it this? Yep,
exactly. And now, is Obi the oldest brother?
You have to be patient, Bob.
The reason why I was wondering is the middle one who blinks. I was like, is that a real condition or did he do that through the whole? And he did a great job.
He did.
Yeah.
He did. And then the last actor who plays Ugo, he plays the role of Kunole Reme.
I want you to pronounce his real name.
I will. Are you ready?
Yes.
His real name is Yokono Opiemi Alawemi.
Very good.
I think.
We think.
but he's a Nigerian actor, producer, filmmaker, motivational speaker, entrepreneur. He was born in Banu State. And Banu States, these are just like our states within the country of Nigeria.
Oh.
But he moved his family to Abadan when he was a child. Oh, he got moved there when he was a child. Once he graduated high school, he studied fisheries and wildlife management at the University of Abadan. Then he attended another university and studied tourism and hospitality. And once he all his degrees finished, he did spend some time in New York City to study acting at the New York Film Academy. And was cast in his first movie before he graduated. But I couldn't find any credits for him, but it sounds like he's done some acting in the U.S.
What I'm amazed is, of these four principals, it seems like only one started out to be an actor.
Right.
The rest all kind of backed into it, and they're all very, very good.
They're really good. I found the acting in this this production to be fascinating. And again, it reminded me why we do this. And mm-hmm. one of the many things is to discover new talent, see a different way of storytelling. And so I found this film to be, well, we'll talk about it a little bit later, but just well acted, well produced, well directed.
Yes.
So, Bob, I know you're asking about who's who and stuff, but so tonight I'm going to talk about this movie in sort of a different way, right? I'm going to talk about the three boys and their mama. And then I'm going to talk about what happens. Then I'm going to talk about, now here's where it gets interesting. And then I'm going to talk about Christmas Day.
Okay.
Because, this movie really starts off with, opens up with Mama and her friends who are part of this group. They're called the Ladies of the Undiluted Destiny Society.
I love that name, actually.
And Bob, do you know what? So if you think about that, so Ladies of the Undiluted Destiny Society, or if you think about an acronym for them, you know it would be?
Destiny. Luds?
Louds.
the Louds, yes. Yeah.
So, and I saw a description of them. They're, think about it, impeccably dressed people, women in blouses and wrappers and colorful turbans and head ties, you know, kind of crafted from the best fabric in the world. And just think about a group of 7 upper-class women who rule the roost wherever they go, right?
And very colorful. You're right, very colorful.
Very colorful. And, but Mama or sister Agatha. She's the leader. But they're meeting and they're discussing the upcoming Christmas show. Mama Agatha, again, she's the leader. She has kind of this nemesis with Deaconess Facordi, who's truly trying to nudge her way and trying to run the show, but Mama has nothing to do with it.
And she definitely seems like high-end, like she has money and, yeah.
The Deaconess?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yeah. And so Mama Agatha was feeling a little jealous because the Deaconess is talking about her kids getting married and going to have a baby. And so, she's kind of decides that she's going to tell her sons, get them together. She gets them together over sort of feigning that she's ill and that she's her heart's hurting or having a heart attack. And, you know, she tells her sons that whoever gets engaged by Christmas will inherit the family home when she dies. So she brings them all to the hospital and just going through it. And right, they're all kind of looking at their feet and saying, oh, I got a girlfriend. And they're like, no, you don't. Right. But let's chat about the three boys, right? Mm-hmm. Because they're the main character. So Ugo, mm-hmm. right? He's the oldest.
Okay.
Right.
Yep.
So he's sort of a player, right? He owns his own recording studios, you know, a lot like Jake, who does our sound, right? Jake, Ugo, I'm going to get them mixed up during this meeting, but he's a player, although Jake's married, so he's maybe not a player.
Yeah.
He better not
in be his day.
In his day.
Yeah.
But, you know, Ugo brings women into the recording studio, swoons them about how he's this big record producer. But he's business partners with a woman named Cassie. But we find out early on that they owe money to a loan shark named Tony Torpedo.
Don't you love that name?
I love that
Tony Torpedo. And what I also love is he's not like your stereotypical loan shark.
The least intimidating loan shark I've ever seen.
Steve Urkel grew up to be a loan shark.
Exactly. Ugo, right, is in this partner. But in one of the opening scenes, though, he does meet a woman who's in the studio when Tony Torpedo comes in. We don't know her identity at the beginning. I'll whisper a little bit ahead, but she's sister Agake. But Tony or Ugo doesn't know it at the time, but he sort of has this interaction early in the movie, but then goes away for most of the movie until later on. But each time Tony visits Ugo and Cassie and they don't pay, Tony takes away equipment, TVs, soundboard, speakers, even at one point takes away all of Ugo's furniture.
I know.
And also no one knows about the family debt. So that's Ugo, oldest player, right? Then comes Obi. Obi is the person who's the middle child. He's a little bit on the nervous side, as you said. He looks to sort of have this early advantage in the race to get married because he's about to propose to his girlfriend, Vera. And he sets up this elaborate scene, gets his brothers involved. He's broadcasting live on social media. You know, he comes out and he's holding, he has a crown on his head.
He has a crown.
With the capes. And he's kind of going over to Vera and he gets on a knee and gives her a crown. And he puts the crown on her head and proposes. And she says,
no.
Right. And
he goes viral.
It goes viral, right? And he's going viral, like Vera, 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 Vera. And his brothers are absolutely brutal to him about this, and keeps making fun of him throughout the movie, saying
Vera, "Go, go, Vera, go." Vera.
But I would hope I would be better to my brothers if this happened to them, but I'm not 100% I would.
I don't think so.
I want to think I would be, but I don't think I would be. But we come to find out that Vera, though, is Obi's boss. Mm-hmm. And there is also another woman in the office named Kane, and she's recently broken up with her boyfriend. And because this is a rom-com, there's multiple stories lying. Of course, Kane really likes Obi, doesn't like the way Vera's treating him. But that's sort of the introduction.
She's like the best buddy who listens to all his problems. And you know he belongs with her, but he wants Vera, who's, you know, the boss.
And she's pretty.
Pretty attractive.
Yeah, she is. And then the last one, the youngest boy is called Chike. He's the youngest and he's very doting on his mom. You know, seems to be the one most focused on her well-being. He's really quiet about his love life, almost secretive. And he seems to always be just a little bit late and a little bit picked on by his brother. So that's the introduction to Mama.
The funniest thing about him, what I was going to say is, and I don't know, so he kept getting a phone call from Samuel, who ends up being the girlfriend, but I thought it was going to come, I thought he was going to come out and be, that was his boyfriend, and that was going to be the storyline, but it wasn't. So I was surprised.
Yeah, definitely. That's a good pickup. I did not pick that in the beginning. So that's sort of the introduction, but what happens next, right? So how does this start evolving? So Ugo, right, he's the player, needing money to pay off his debt, conspires with his business partner, Cassie, to say, okay, here's the plan. We're going to go home. I'm going to introduce you as my fiance, right? You're going to meet Mama. We're going to get the money, right, when we sell the house, and then we'll pay off our debt and everything's great, right? So that's the plan. So he goes home. He introduces Cassie to Mama. Mama says, well, I'd like to talk to Cassie for a couple minutes, one-on-one.
Don't you love that, oh, Mama? Yeah. You got to pass Mama's test.
Yep. And after just a few minutes, Mama can see right through this and says, like, no, I am not going to bless this. And I love the part when Cassie looks at Ugo, looks at Mama, looks at Ugo, and says, she's good. So that was Ugo's sort of attempt on it. Obi, meanwhile, right? He decides, well, I'm going to try to make Vera jealous. And so I'm going to start paying more attention to Kane. And it's working so well that Kane is starting to show her true feelings towards Obi. And Obi's back. So they're trying to show each other's feelings towards one another. But Vera sort of tricks Obi into saying, I do love you. I do want to love you. I just want to take my time. I was scared. And as long as you can help me win this big contract, because they're all working together, like once we win the contract, I'll show you. I'll love you. And he sort of...
Didn't you want to slap Obi? Like, wake up. What's going on here?
You idiot.
What are you doing?
What are you doing?
Look at the girl next to you. Exactly. She's awesome.
Yeah, she's beautiful. She's smart.
Funny.
She's into you. Yeah. But anyway, she promises this, right? That if they can win this contract, they can re-kind of kindle their romance. Also, we found that out at this venture in the movie that Kane's boyfriend relationship is over. And we'll talk a little bit about who that is in the future. Chike, right, still secretive, right? He's getting these phone calls. But it starts to come out, though, that he is actually seeing Sammy, who's a woman, who is a married woman, who's a part of the Louds.
The Louds, yes. Right? The youngest one of the Louds.
The youngest one of the Louds. And so that's why he's been secretive so far.
And he didn't know she was married.
I think she did. I think he did.
Oh, he did?
Yeah, because in the movie he says, you told me you were going to leave her, right?
Oh, yeah, you're right.
But so he knows. And I think from his perspective is he thinks they're about to split.
Yes, right? That's right.
And so also what's happening now is Mama Agatha decides against the wishes of her deaconess Fakadori to sponsor the gala is going to be held in sort of the poorest part of town.
Which I love that part of the storyline. I really did that she insisted that they have it there.
Yeah. And yeah, I think you brought up a really good point where the deaconess is clearly – you know, thinks very highly of herself, right? And she wanted to have it near the parish where they are to kind of show off her friends, right? That the Louds are sponsoring this great event. But, you know, Sister Agatha or Mama, right? She decides, like, we're going to have it in Mushin, which, again, is a poor part of town. And
doesn't she say something like, this is what Christmas is for?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. And also at this point in time, Mama makes your boys all go to church. You're going to attend church with me this week. And it's then where Ugo sees this beautiful woman singing. It's the woman he saw in the beginning. Sister Adike is what they call her in the movie. She's singing this glorious song. She's a very attractive woman, beautiful voice. And he's just sort of falling in love with her. And after she sings, the pastor gets up and says, all right, we need a new drummer in our band. Who's going to volunteer? And Ugo like raises his hand immediately. And his mom is like, what are you doing? You don't even belong to this parish. She's like, I want to do it. And so Ugo volunteers to be the drummer in the chorus. It's funny. They put him through a series of questions to become the drummer. And they say, well, we normally wouldn't probably allow you in, but since you're Sister Agatha's son, we're going to let you in. And so he starts to, you know, hang around with Sister Attica a little bit more. So that's the background. So what happens? So here's where it gets interesting, Bob. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, sit down. Take a deep breath. This is a rom-com. So here's what gets interesting. Obi now, right? So again, he's Vera's, peon. Obi, after being stood up once again, they win the big contract, and Obi's getting all ready, thinking they're going to, rekindle the relationship. She doesn't show up. And so she stood up again. Vera confuses his love and attraction for Kane, right? She thinks that, well, maybe she really likes Kane more. But it's Vera and Obi aren't just going to happen. So they profess each other love, where it gets another interesting turn. It's Kane's boyfriend that she just broke up with is none other than Tony Torpedo.
Yes.
Right? Why not?
Yeah.
Right? The person who Ugo owes money to. So Tony approaches Obi in the most romantic gesture ever, says, I'll leave you alone and let you date Kane if you pay me double of what Ugo owes me.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And Obi is surprised because he didn't know about the money. He didn't know anything about what trouble Ugo was in. And also at the same time he's visiting, he actually sees Sister Ajika coming out of a meeting with Tony Torpedo and sort of draws conclusions like, why is she in there?
Right.
Right. And so that's Obi. Meanwhile, Sister Ajika and Obi are falling in love. Mm-hmm. They're enjoying being with each other. They're working together on the Christmas pageant. She kind of shares with him that she grew up in Mushin and that her childhood was very much lived in poverty. Ugo wants to get serious with Ajika. She's sort of interested too, but she says, Ugo, you need to go to the church. The church has to bless
our relationship. Love that. Not only do you have to apply for the drummer, but he has to apply to be her boyfriend.
So she goes back, and it's really a funny thing. And the one older, think about an older statesman of the church, right, about the pastoral board, and he's like, I know you, Ugo. You hit and run. You hit and run. There'll be no hit and run with Sister Ajika. And he's like, no hit and run. And the other guy's like, there'll be no premarital sex. And Ugo goes, why? And so then the guy's like, well, he's like, what am I going to do? He's like, take cold showers. So, but Ugo does it, right? Yeah. He's very, very serious about it.
And just on the comment what you made, when she talks about that she grew up in Mushin and she was poor, it is not the classic, I came from a hard and had a bad life and now things are, she very loved. I mean, Mushin, the people are fun. They're absolutely nice. They're just, they live poor.
They live in poverty.
Yeah.
Yep. Ugo is in hot pursuit of Ajika. Obi's, trying to get Kane to fall in love with him. GK, this is kind of near the part of the movie where he kind of gets the courage to go and he's just going to profess his love to Sammy, say that they want to get married, right? Because they've been sort of dating on the slide. And he goes and goes to Sammy's door and the husband opens the door. Mm-hmm. And he is just heartbroken and devastated. So he thinks that they're going to break up, but he was ready to propose on that day. And I'm sure he's thinking, if I bring her home, mom is going to love her because she already knows her.
Right, right.
But that doesn't happen. At the Christmas party, at the Christmas festival that they've planned, Ugo and Obi get in a fight. Obi tells Ugo that he saw Sister Ajika meeting with Tony Torpedo, And sort of infers that she's not really the angel you think she is.
Right.
Anybody who's going to be associated with him must be on the dark side, must not be a good person.
Yeah, in it for the money, all that.
And for the money, right. You know, and Ugo is very upset. So he confronts Sister Ajika about visiting Tony, accuses her of being a fake, and how could she be hanging out with Tony, instituting that maybe she's one of his girls. And she is hurt and she storms off. Ugo, sort of sensing maybe that wasn't a good strategy, tries to call her multiple times and, you know, she doesn't return his calls. So it kind of gets interesting, right? Because now Ubi,
everything's going bad.
Everything's going bad. Everything's
except the festival.
Except the festival.
That's when you said, talk about an outdoor thing. That would have been fun to be at.
Yeah, and
the music,
the music and the dancing and the side story too there, the contract that they won, that Obi helped win for Vera, was an electrical company, electrical wire company. So they make this massive Christmas tree out of electrical wire, and like the people sponsor it, right? So the church gets help in sponsoring the event. So it's kind great. Of a fun part of it. Yep. So that leads up. So now it's Christmas Day, Bob, right? We've been through all the rom-com stuff that we could do. But it's, and like I said, I hate throughout the thing. At this point, I kept talking to Louis, like, come on, just tell her you're sorry. Just shut up. But Obi is sitting in the recording studio now. It's on Christmas Day. Right? She's going to go see mom later. And Tony Torpedo comes back. And Tony Torpedo's carrying things back into the building, putting his receiver back, his speakers. And Obi's confused, saying, like, what are you doing? Like, why are you bringing this back? He goes, well, your debts have been paid.
Yes.
He's like, well, who paid it? And he's like, Ugo has paid off your debts.
Your brother.
His brother. And so he starts to feel like crap, right? Because he's had this big fight with him. And
and kind of mistreated him through the whole movie.
Right. And Tony also shares that Sister Ajika had come as well to plea on his behalf, because we find out that Sister Ajika and Tony Torpedo both grew up in Mushin together. So now Obi's feeling twice bad. So my brother's bailed me out. My girl, who I've accused of being maybe fake, is pure, and she's actually out there fighting for me. But now he's dejected, and he is going to the Christmas party at Mama's, sort of feeling that way. Ugo, meanwhile, is excited. He and Kane have developed a relationship. He brings Kane to the Christmas dinner.
Finally.
Mama says, let me have a word with her. Let me speak to her. And they go off, and they see them, and they're bracing, and they're smiling. And, of course, Kane is just the most genuine person.
Yes, exactly.
Complimenting
you
the house.
You knew Mama was going to love it.
Yeah, and she comes back, and she sort of blesses them. Yeah. So, you know, they become engaged. They're all sitting down to dinner, right? Chike's there. I mean, he's heartbroken, unfortunately. Nothing mends his heart. But then as they're sitting down, Ube looks across the room, and there's Sister Ajika.
Yes.
And he's just like, doesn't know what to do. So he goes up and he apologizes again. And Sister Ajika isn't really looking to forgive him. But he's like, why are you here? And she's like, well, Obi, Kane, Chiki, Mama, everybody came to me and said, you need to come, give him a second chance. You are a changed man. And that, you know, that I'm here to maybe mend our ways. And then you cue the happy music.
Yeah.
And so there's a few other little twists at the end that I'll leave out, but yeah,
it's a Christmas miracle.
It's a Christmas miracle. It is a Christmas miracle, but sounds like you liked the movie, Bob.
And, yes.
Give me some of your feedback. Was it
so
festive?
It was festive because like I told you, I love the celebration in Mushin. I love the fact that they had it there. I love they show some of the quirky people, that how they tie all the storylines together, that becomes like the high point. So, and you know what, when you talk about emotions, I feel about it was fun. Yeah. I enjoyed it. It was like a fun ride.
Yeah, I agree. I was, again, there was the interaction between different people and just, you know, you're like, you're missing the boat on stuff. But I mean, it's funny. Like, I find that as a positive. When I get pulled into the movie and I'm sort of vested in the characters.
When you're talking to the screen.
Yeah. You know, I got that from my mom. But like, I thought it was a festive. It was all about Christmas, about the magic of Christmas. I felt very happy at the end of the movie.
Yeah. Yep.
What about the future? Would you watch it again?
Yes, I would, because I think it's one of those ones that are like, you know what, when you want to lift your mood and kind of feel, you know, because there's a beat to it. There's a charge to it. You know, the music's good. It's a nice little, I don't know, a ride. You know,
would you recommend this movie?
I would, because I think it's really good to get some introspection on Africa too. Yeah. In Nigeria has such a bad reputation, at least in the U.S. the Nigerian prince and scammers and all this stuff. I thought it was a great, you know, you saw a lot of different things about Nigeria that I enjoyed.
Yeah. Do you want to learn how to say Merry Christmas?
Yeah. Can I say it in English? Merry Christmas.
Very, very good. Well, it's funny because there are 550 tribes in the country of Nigeria.
Oh, my gosh.
And so there's a lot of different ways to say Merry Christmas, right? We could probably spend a couple of shows kind of go through them all. Many different languages are spoken, but English is the official language in Nigeria. So most would understand Merry Christmas if you're there. But I thought we could focus on Yoruba. It's the language spoken in southwest and central Nigeria, and it's spoken by about 50 million people.
Oh, so that's pretty popular.
Pretty popular, yeah. Yep. And so, are you ready?
Yeah.
I'm not.
Okay.
No, it's Ordon Keresimasi. Ordon Keresimasi.
Ordon Keresimasi. Wow.
Yep. So, obviously, Ordon is happy, and Keresimasi is Christmas. So it's like Happy Christmas. Ordon Keresimasi.
Yeah. It almost sounds kind of Asian, which is funny, you know?
Yeah.
Keresimasi. Yeah.
It could be my accent too. But let's talk a little bit about the cultures too.
Oh, yeah.
Impacts in Nigeria. So with an estimated 60% of the population identifying as Christian. Yeah. Christmas is arguably a celebrated holiday in Nigeria, right? Yeah. It's a big holiday. Nigerian Christians enthusiastically celebrate Christmas. They have traditions that are uniquely Nigerian, though. Nigerians love making Christmas a huge family event. And we saw that in the movie, right?
Yep.
Christmas Day, there's going to be 40 or 50 people at Mama's house. Some families are separated by a lot of distance, as some live in large cities, while the majority of their families are out in villages. So think about urban versus rural. And so the city dwellers often return home for Christmas to see grandparents and older relatives for the holiday season.
Oh, so it's like a return home kind of.
It is.
Back home.
Yeah. Yep. December in Nigeria, there's usually a month-long festival period where everyone is bubbling. Thousands of Nigerians from around the globe make a kind of triumphant return back home.
Yep.
And it's funny, a guy who I work with, Andre, you maybe heard me talk to him before, he went back to Nigeria for a wedding in December. And I thought it was interesting at the time, probably 3 or 4 years ago, like who's going to have a wedding during December? But it kind of speaks to this where people come home, they try to plan big family events and they have concerts and all different festivals throughout the whole month of December. Of course, there's also always food around Christmas. So rice and tomato stew, that's the traditional Christmas meal. And with a generous helping of chicken, it's probably what you'll see in most families' kitchens and being served on Christmas Day. Jollof rice, fried rice, coconut rice are just some of the varieties you'll find on Christmas table.
A lot of rice,
right. You can hear friends asking, where is my Christmas rice? Or I will visit you for my Christmas rice. So, I've never had jollof rice. Have you?
I have not, but I've heard of it before. I hear people talk about jollof rice.
Yeah, we have to put that on our list to do.
Yeah.
For the future.
Well, we invite all our listeners over for our huge spread of all the various foods.
I think that would be so cool.
Wouldn't that be cool? That would be awesome.
I mean, as we talked before, like just being outside, but the rice is typically served with chicken or with goat, and could be combined with other desserts and appetizers. This is why some companies gift workers rice prior to the holiday.
Oh, that's nice. Yeah. I mean, it's like a turkey, but it's here's your rice.
In villages, you may be greeted by the numerous masquerade groups made up of young people who display their dance and moves for money. And at a Christmas time ritual, there's a cultural tradition young men and women take to the streets in scary costumes, hoping to collect cash from visitors or tips or donations. These dances are groups and significant part of the Christmas experience. Sort of the thrill of being chased by the village masquerade.
Well, that's kind of interesting. It's kind of a Halloweenish thing, but yeah.
It does kind of come. And you saw it a little bit too when they're in Mushin and they're celebrating, right, the dancers. They weren't masked, but they're all sort of dancing around the streets.
Oh,
And it was everybody. It was the whole community dancing. Nigerians will set off knockout or bangers during the Christmas season. That's what they call fireworks. Typically, it begins on Christmas Eve and lasts until New Year's Eve.
Now we're finding that that is a common theme in these warmer climates, fireworks for Christmas.
Yeah. They do. Yeah. And we even saw it in the Italian movie, The Perfect Family, right? Wasn't there fireworks?
Yes, there was. Yeah.
The difference between Santa Claus and the Nigerian Father Christmas is their personality. The Nigerian Father Christmas is an eccentric who does not hide but dances in public to entertain the thrilled crowds of children. He also gives out Christmas gifts by hand or throws them into the air instead of delivering them at night.
Oh, so that's interesting. So instead of sneaking in your house and you never really see him, he's outside dancing around. That's kind of fun.
It is kind of fun.
Yeah.
This calls for some Christmas music.
Yes, this Christmas music.
What kind of Christmas music is that?
Least you could do is play some Christmas music.
And now back to Christmas music.
So, want to review some music?
Oh, I love the music.
My yellow Christmas, this Christmas. My yellow Christmas, this Christmas.
Yellow.
So that song, can you guess what it's called? Yellow Christmas. So yellow is a color in Africa which represents amusement and happiness and harmony and culture. That song was sung by Mohammed Amamashan, who was born in Lagos, Nigeria. But his stage name is Mulugo.
Oh.
So you might hear more about him as Mulugo throughout searching for him. But the lyrics are, my yellow Christmas is for joy, my yellow Christmas your love I pray for. He sings the song that's to bring joy and hope during the Christmas season. And so I think it was a very upbeat song.
Did I hear some English in there? I think he went back. Yeah.
Which I believe it was Yoruba in English that he was doing. Uh-huh. But I'm not an expert in Yoruba. Yes. But I believe I read somewhere that it was Yoruba.
Okay, cool. Yes.
So as we're wrapping up, Bob, I have a question for you. So, you know, been thinking about, we've reviewed a lot of films so far. But is there a film, if you had the opportunity, is there a film you would remake or recast that to make it better? Was there one you might like maybe change the story somewhat? And, you know, just think about, you get to be the director right now, and you can take on any of the films we review today, including tonight's, and like, which one would you take, and maybe like, what would you want to maybe remake in it?
Well, the first thing I'd say is, I think we've been remarkably lucky that most every single film I've really enjoyed. So I think I could think two things. One is I think I would do the India one. I think that could be redone. It could be done. I don't know if I'd I liked David and I liked all the actors. I think the story could have been tightened. Yeah. You know, you could have recast it, maybe even make it a little more serious. So I think that one could have been redone and done better. And the other one I'd think about is Tokyo Godfathers, but in real, not animated, like with real characters. Like, I think that could be very emotional, you know.
I like that one. That's, I, yeah, I mean, with the indie movie, you couldn't make it worse.
Yeah.
you know, for me, the one I would want to redo is Mononcle Antoine.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I just felt wanting more. Like, I wanted to know, how did Antoine become the way he was? An alcoholic, just sort of angry at the whole world. And then in Bonet, like, why is he so fascinated? How does he have such a strong connection? And why does he want to go see the family of the teenager who died? Like, when he goes back and sort of how the movie ends. Like, I just feel like both of those stories need a little bit more to be said.
You are absolutely right. In fact, now that you say that, I remember my feelings at the end of that movie, scratching my head going, I hope Mark can explain to me what that just what I just watched, because I didn't understand it at all. So I think you're right. That could be, you know, and even though it gets all the awards and the, you know, people, the acclaim that how great it was, I think it could be redone a little bit better.
So, so we're going to do some fundraising. Send your money in to know so we can raise money to redo our films.
Yeah.
But let's end the night with a little quote.
Okay.
Okay. The one I picked tonight was, Christmas is a family event of strangers. Christmas is a family event of strangers. What that says to me is, right, during the Christmas season, during the Christmas, like, we're just one big community. People are nicer to one another. Interactions are different. So,
that's perfect, because you know what? It's very simple sentence, but if you think about it, it's significant and meaningful, because strangers and family are together, you know?
Right, isn't it?
Yeah.
Family, yeah. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So, Bob, thanks for spending some time with
Mark, me. Mark, I feel like dancing. I feel like putting on some really colorful clothes and dancing around.
And I'm going to wear yellow.
Yeah. Hey, yeah, Jake, put the yellow back on. We're gonna have a dance off here.
Yeah, remember, guys, want your feedback. Send us movies or songs, or if we are mispronouncing things, leave a recorded message. But you can get us on Facebook.
I think you just said that so we'll get email, because you know we're mispronouncing things. But hats off to you for that actor's full name. That was quite impressive.
I practiced in the mirror. Yeah, okay. But thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Hope to run into you someplace on the street.
Actually, we're done.
Done.
It's over. Over. It's over.
It's over. Kaput. Finito.
It's over. It's over.
Oh. This has been a Waysound Studio production.
And sound engineering on our show is by Jake Fontana.